So today, I don't know if you have read the title of the workshop. We decided to invite you in to your own kitchen and start looking at your kitchen with different, not eyes, because you only have one eyes, but in different light. That's what we call it, to glow in the dark kitchen. So we will now learn, for me, that I'm a biologist and I normally run a biohacking space here at Socotec. What I try to do is to teach biology to the people, but using the elements that they have around. And I normally, the only thing that I really, really, really like that happens when the people come to the workshops is that they go home with things to do and to repeat, but also with a little concept that they maybe didn't know about science, but now they know it. And they know it in an easy way, and they are feel comfortable about that. My aim for today is to teach you about different kinds of properties that the light has. We call them, a lot of people call them bioluminescence. They are luminescence in general. Inside of this big name, there are several ways that light can behave. The most famous one is the bioluminescence, right? You say, no, it's not famous. Yeah, it is, because you have a lot of pictures of squids that they are glowing in the dark. You have seen fireflies or glowworms. I don't know if the Americans or the English, how they say that. Then you have also, by the way, the squids are not the ones that are actually glowing. The ones that are glowing are a little bacteria that live within the squid. It's called vibrofusheri. And they are really, really important in science. Also, there are these pictures of the beaches in the, I think it's northeast of Japan, that they are glowing in the dark and the people go there to see them. This happens because tiny little algae that are in the plankton, they are called Pyrocystis lunae. And a few years ago, they became famous because some people just put it inside of jars with the shape of a dinosaur, and they sell it to the people. So you got a tiny tank fish in the shape of a dinosaur that contain these algae that are able to glow in the dark. What for me it's amazing is that even I said you, I'm talking about insects, worms, fungi, the honey mushroom, as it's called in English, that they glow also in the dark. They are famous since the Greeks. All of these are from all the kingdoms of all the living things on Earth. But only one protein, it's the responsible for that behavior. The protein is called luciferase. So even if you found it in different species, this protein just appeared during the evolution and it has been appearing in different species afterwards. How it works? It uses another name. So I said bioluminescence. Another name is chemiluminescence. So it's when a chemical reaction produces light. In that case, the chemical component that's doing this job is an enzyme, so a protein, that's called luciferase, and uses oxygen as one of the ingredients, one of the reagents of the reaction. Chemiluminescence is also very famous. You don't know it because you don't call it chemiluminescent sticks. You call it glow-in-the-dark sticks, but they are the typical ones that you have in the when you go in a club and the people just break them and then they start glowing. What happens when you break them is that the cylinder that's inside of the outside cylinder breaks, and when it's broken, then the liquid that was in the inner one escapes, and then the mixture starts a chemical reaction that one of the results of that chemical reaction is light. So chemiluminescence. Are we going today to talk about chemiluminescence or bioluminescence? No, but they were important too. We will talk today about fluorescence, which is a property of fluorescence. That is very easy to explain, okay? Something is fluorescent when it's able to take light in one wavelength form, normally high, or at least higher than the one that they will later emit. So I take high energy wavelength light, and then I convert it, I kept some of the energy for me, and then I convert it to another wavelength light that is slower, it's lower. This is one of the properties that we can see in the jellyfish. These jellyfish that they are famous because they grow, they are glowing in the sea, this one doesn't use luciferase because the property is not bioluminescence, it's fluorescence. So they take one wavelength and they convert it into the other one. They normally take red light, so high energy wavelength, kind of red, and then they convert it in green. Most famous one that was discovered in biology, and the people who discovered it win the Nobel Prize, of course. It's called green fluorescent protein. They won the Nobel Prize for discovering and for being in marketing. So the green fluorescent protein is now one of the most important discoveries in biology. It's like, since we discover it, we can take any protein inside of any cell, and then we can put that protein next to it, and now a protein that you cannot see, you can see them. So just imagine that you are in a dark forest and no one can see you. And then I thought, how can I follow them if I cannot see them? So I give you a lantern. Now the forest is dark, but when you move, I can follow the light, so I know where you are. I know if you are a lot or if you are few. And that's why the fluorescence was so important in biology that it won a Nobel Prize. And we even have a special microscopes only based on that. There is a kind of fluorescence that is a little bit more cooler, because it's not that they take the energy, the light, and then convert it in another wavelength and give it to you, but they are able to do that with a delay on time. That's what we call phosphorescence. And this is really famous. You can see it in the signals that you can see when you shut down the light. You know, you sell it the stickers, normally stars or something for the kids. Then in Halloween, everybody glow. It's everybody is becoming a phosphorescent person in that sense, okay? Two famous components can do that. The zinc sulfide and the strontium aluminate. You can see that, you can read about them in Wikipedia, and you can have a lot of videos of taking things or how to make it that powder at home. Okay, but they are phosphorescent per se, okay? More things to say about that. A lot of these powders that are phosphorescent, they are phosphorescent, or they glow the most when you shut down the lights and you don't use the normal visible spectrum of light. So you choose normally what we call the black light, right? When you go to the clubs and they have this special light. How does that work? How is this working? I want to show you how this works, but it's much easier with a picture. And it's this one. See? So you have all the light from the sun, and then we are always centered in humans. So for us, the light only is this part, the visibles. So when you light something that's red, what you are saying is that when the 700 wavelength is coming back from an object, you like it more than when another wavelength is reflected on there. But the sunlight contains much more wavelengths than that. They are the infrareds, so they are high energy, or long wavelengths, more than 700. And then you have the ultraviolets, which they are like less wavelength because they are between 2-something, 200-something, and almost 400. But now you are already entering in the realm of the blues. Why I'm telling you? Because the black light, it's in this threshold. Who knows that? So just to broke you a little bit your anthropogenic view, I also have this image. So this is how you see the yellow flower, because your eyes can capture visual, what we call the visible spectrum of light. But if you are a bee, you have the option, the eyes allow them to go a little bit inside of the ultraviolet, and then different marks on the flowers appear. Because there are many things around us that when we change the light in when we see it, then we can see them. There are many things around us that when we change the light, they become fluorescent, okay? To show you that I'm not getting crazy, and I'm not crazy, okay, what I will do is switch, I bought that, very important, and ultraviolet, but not cancerous, because it's an important thing. If you want to do that at home, you need only to buy this. This is a light that has LEDs that are at 395 wavelength. So it's ultraviolet, but it stays in the rang of A ultraviolet, UVA rays, the ones that you will take if you go to get tanned. They can penetrate to the surface of your skin, but not that much. The ultraviolet B, they are already dangerous. And if you go to C, that's the ones that you can receive when the ozone layer is broken, then they are even more cancerous. So very important, not too much, not too less. 395 wavelength. So if you close it, you can see that I was not getting totally crazy. What I have here, now in the near of my hand here, it's something that we like to drink, normally in clubs, and this is water. Water doesn't have a fluorescent property. So if you illuminate them with an ultraviolet, that's a light that your eye has problems to receive, you cannot see it. But when you have this magic liquid here, the ultraviolet light, it's going inside, and then some substance that's inside have the property of changing that wavelength to the blue. That now is something that your eye can't see. What do you think that I have here? And to show that it's nothing wrong, I'm gonna drink it. Well, I'm happy to tell you that that's tonic water. So it's just what you add to gin tonic, except for the gin. And the substance that's inside is called quinine. So if you can switch on the light. Did you know that? So the substance in English, I write it down, it's quinine. Okay? More tricks. Water is always my negative control, so you see that I'm not telling you lies. I'm gonna ask a volunteer. Now we will take some multivitamin tablets, maybe four of them, and we will try to smash it and filter it. And then for another volunteer, we have a little bit of a spinach. You can see they are spinach. They are not fresh. They are from yesterday that I brought it. And now you are going to hack for sure, because I never did it with alcohol that it's drinkable. Okay, you should use, if you really want to work it, use the normal alcohol that you have for your wounds. But since I said that we will be able to drink our experiments today, I just bought, not trademark, alcoholic drink that it's almost 400% alcohol. Okay, so we will prepare a very healthy. You know, you have to smash that with some, I think I have it around me here. You can have this. You maybe will need this, we will see. And this, to smash it. There is no need of being gentle, no. going to take the easy ones. What I'm using is curcuma. And again, we should do it with alcohol, but then we will not be able to drink it. So, since I promise, we will try it with that. And this is, it's... And you need water, which is here. So we will put the powder.
Yeah.
In the, exactly. Ooh! They almost disappeared. Oh, you already did it.
Yeah, yeah.
Ah, perfect. So you can be careful because they are not the best filters in the market. If filtering doesn't work, then we will not be so clean. Mm-hmm. And we will just put it on the water.
Okay.
See.
More water or is it necessary?
See, I'm worried because we don't obtain ara.
I'm there.
So yeah, a little bit more water. And then I will go to help your friend. Oh, no. No. No, it's not, I broke it. So it's totally my fault. I got another one here, just in case. Let's see. No, I will try to be gentle. Not in my... I think we're doing very, very fine.
Yeah.
We are. A little bit more. Let's see. This is totally drinkable if you are a little bit more clean than our.
Yeah.
We are. They are. And now I will show to the camera what it is. But any trademark works in that case. In that case, since now, any trademark should work. I think we got enough.
Yep.
Yeah, and we have more homework to do, so. This, like in a real life, laboratory need to be labeled. Otherwise, we will not know what it is. So we will label like multivitamins, right?
Yep.
Or vitamins. So. Any trademark works. Okay. Let's juice it. Why are we doing that? Of course, the other thing that we did is because we wanted liquid multivitamins. To have the vitamins on the liquid. We are doing this because we want the chlorophyll of the spinach. So if instead of a spinach you have green lettuce, or kale, or anything that's green because of the chlorophyll, it also works, or should work. So not a lot, but we got it. Thank you so much. So now we have the multivitamins. We got the spinach in our gin. This is, again, our water. It's not labeled, but I will do it now. And now we have here the chlorophyll. And I'm gonna do the curcumin or turmeric as you want. And I also will do it with alcohol. And, okay, I will insist in filtering things, but to come, because otherwise they are a little bit too much turbid. Instead of transparent to the light. But you will see anyway the properties. So, have curcum. And then alcohol for link. Okay, and we will let it do it slowly in that case. Not because I run out of spoons and things, but because we want that. This is a little bit more cooler than the other one, so we will do more things. So for starts, what we want to to see if the magic that we have seen with the kinin also happens with this, right? So let's see. We can shoot the switch off the light, and then I will switch on. Oh, we didn't do very well about the chlorophyll, but you see the difference? Were you expecting that the multibeam Dominic will have that color? So we will figure out why this is not working later, but we will try. And now I have a surprise for you. We will try to figure out what is going on. This is also something that you will find in any club. You, not all of them, this is the, no, the gin tonic is, I can't see it because it's glowing in the dark, gin tonic, well, without the gin, gin tonic without the gin. Something that I didn't already told you, that's a surprise we need to figure out. Not all of them have the same color, and not all of them has the same intensity. This is water, by the way. So this one has water and something else. So if we switch on the light, you will see, this is our vitamin, number one. This is number three, here. This is number two. And this is number four. So from this one, I did two different concentrations, so I had the same amount, and then I add a little bit of water. And then for the three, for the two, I was lazy, I only did one. And then we have three, I also did it in two concentrations. And this is our tonic. And here we have our water. So for you to know some, and I give you like a hunch before, some vitamins have this fluorescent property under the ultraviolet light. Mainly, the most studied one is the B2 or riboflavin. So of course, in the multivitaminic, if you read, and if you want to do glow in the dark, healthy, green detox, juices, then, or make your children drink multivitamins, then you need to have a little bit of B2. Here we have 1.6 milligrams for every two pills, and I think we smashed like five. So we have a very high concentration in this trademark, and it says 2 milligrams of B6, 2 micrograms or B12, and then niacin, which is not riboflavin. It's another kind of vitamin, different from these ones. These ones also have B2 and B6, 1.7 milligrams. There's another group of B vitamins, B6 and niacin. We have 8 and 2. And here we have, again, B6 and B12. And then we have B3 or niacin, 8 to 2. So they should have similar. And these are two different tonics on the market with different concentrations of quinine, as you can see, because they are actually glowing different in the dark. So I can tell that this one will be more bitter than this one. Quinine gives you a little bit of bitterness. It's a very characteristic taste of the tonic and comes from that. So if they glow less, they should be less bitter. So if you want to see the effect again, now that you have different concentrations of B2s or B vitamins, the B2, the most important one, but the drink, energy drinks normally have B6 and B12. So Let's see, now that we know what we're having. Now here we have the vitamins, first trademark. And then we have this one, that it's too much diluted. See? And just for comparison, this is water. So energy drinks and the multivitaminic. Smash it and filter it with water. Several pills. And then, as you can see, the tonics. In my eyes, this is shining less than this one, as you can see. So as you can see, or as you can feel, my eyes are telling me, this is much, this is more, this is less, this is more, this is less. Would you believe my eyes? Like something that can do that quantitatively? No. Do the scientists believe their eyes for doing that quantitatively? No. What we do is we use a machine that's called a spectrophotometer. Again, another word that sounds difficult, but it's just a word. Okay. That's how a spectrophotometer works. So you have light, then you decompose your light, then you choose the wavelength that you wish. That's what we have been doing with that. So we are illuminating our samples with just the wavelength that we like. And then we have our sample. In our case, our samples are this. And then we have a sensor that's able to receive the light that it's emitting your sample. And that sensor just quantifies. If you take out the sample, you know how many light is arriving. If you put the sample is eliminating this wavelength and it's converting it into another one. So that's how it does. In the laboratory, we have expensive machines that are normally that size. But if you are in the biohacking world and you want to do it yourself, you can go online. You can go to hacteria.org or maybe DIY Bio. We also have one. And then you can build something this tiny and you can use your mobile phone for actually sensing this. So you can have your own spectrophotometer using the camera of your phone as your sensor. For you to see that even the quantification is something that you can do if you want. So more things. What happens is our chlorophyll didn't work. So we can do two things. We can try it with normal alcohol, or we can move forward and see what happens with our solution of curcumin. In principle, this solution should be working like this. Let's see. Oh, I think we got a winner too this time. Maybe with a little bit more of seaweed. I'll try to do it in the dark with my laptop very near. And what we will try to do is to broke the component, the curcumin, to change it with the pH. Now the curcumin is doing the effect. What we can do now is add a little bit of lemon. Let's see if we still have it. Change the color of the water. So, let's see if the trick has worked or not. No, we didn't add enough. Espera. We don't have to switch off the light. I'm gonna do it in the dark. We really concentrated. Well, you can also do it with acid, with real acid, not lemon. You actually need to do it with chloridic acid. And see, I switch off the light. And in principle, if you are using acid enough, the curcumin will lose the shape. And if the molecular chemicals change the shape, they do lost. Well, not the shape, but they in that case it doesn't lose the shape, but does the properties because of the acidity, and is not fluorescent anymore. But if then you add something basic, for example, baking soda solution, you add it to the mixture, then the pH became neutral again, and it will glow in the dark again. We did it too much hacking, so we maybe want to try it again. Or if not, we did all the experiments in the kitchen, and we can do the final one in the laundry room. You want to try it again? Let's try to do chlorophyll with this one. And we will try to do this one again, and then see if with vinegar we are more lucky. Is that okay? So let's do it. More curcuma and filters. And now we will do it with real alcohol. One. This is hacking, you have to have the feeling. Like maybe 2-3 spoons. And these are the spinach. Never. Real alcohol. 96 degrees, almost, no, 70 degrees instead of 38. The alcohol, maybe it will help you. This is supposed to be a very raw, dirty method of extracting chlorophyll. If you want to do that and do it properly, you can keep that on your kitchen for one night and do it the next day. So then the chlorophyll will be on the alcohol, okay? You have to smash it well and wait, which requires patience, and that's something we should have thought yesterday, and I didn't do it yesterday, so. But the real proper way to do it is this one. Blender, alcohol, and then you wait. And then when you are filtering, you keep waiting and you don't try to do it in less than 5 minutes. That's what we did before. That's a very important process. We are learning by doing, and that requires doing more than once. Always. So let's see if it's... I need someone to put alcohol here, because now alcohol is our negative control. Negative control is a concept in experiments that's something that you expect to be, the answer be no for sure, negative control. So we do not expect the alcohol inside of this glass to have fluorescence. If by any case it does, then we have to ask ourselves, is the plastic, is the alcohol? Because then the fluorescence that we'll be sensing from our sample maybe is not from the sample. It could be from the glass or from the alcohol. Well, I think I've been patient enough. Curcuma here, spinach. We are getting there. So, as I said, if we were patient and we do it overnight, then the chlorophyll will have that effect much more easily. So, you see it? It's in red. That's the normal chlorophyll wavelength. I don't know, the camera probably will not be able to see, but your eyes, it's so cool. So now if you buy Spinax, cheaper ones, super expensive ones, you can smash it overnight, same amount of grams, have this light, and know how much chlorophyll you have for your price. So yes, chlorophyll glows in the dark, and not glows in the dark, for now it's fluorescence under the UV light. And then let's see if the curcuma changes color when we add curcumin in ethanol, and then chlorophyll with ethanol. Ethanol is the chemical fancy way of saying alcohol. This alcohol is only 70%, and the gin that we use is 35.5. So now what we can do, we do it the other way around and see if I was not telling you a lie, saying that if you mess up with the pH, then the curcumin will lose the property of fluorescence. What we will do is do it the other way around. So we have a lot of vinegar here. It's not pH 1, but should be if you use chlorhydric acid or sulfhydric acid or sulfuman. I don't know how you call it, sulfuman in English, that's for cleaning. Normally the people use it for the toilets or the swimming pool. So let's see what happens if we do that. Have my light. This glows like that, this glows much less. Maybe I added too much. Can we do another? But it's already, it's also the dilution, but it should be less bright. Would you say that's less bright?
Yeah,
yes. But if you really want to know it, then we should do it with the acid, the really, really acid thing. But again, this, you can use it in your salad, and then you can have a UV romantic dinner onto the lights and you can drink it. If you do it with the toilet cleaning acid chlorhydric acid, then you cannot drink it, okay? So you have to do it changing this for the gin and changing the acid for the toilet cleaning by vinegar or lemon. Lemon is much more acid than the vinegar sometimes. So we succeeded, we have the chlorophyll. I show it to you. Proper way to do it, overnight with a lot of alcohol. Then we do the curcumin. With that, we can leave the kitchen and we can go to the laundry. This is soap and this is soap. You can see if I move it, they do foam, then more foam. These, do you think they are suspicious of being fluorescent? One of them seems suspicious of that. Which one you will say? Yeah, it looks very suspicious. It is. Can we switch off the light? Oh! Oh, this is really, really, really fluorescent, isn't it? This is something that if you don't want to buy the glow-in-the-dark powder, then you can be a cheaper person. You can use this soapy dilution. Like, yes, you can use it. You can see this one. I did it down, but you need to be really near to see because I did it very finely. Down, I use the soap that has the fluorescent protein. Up, I use the soap that does not. And I only painted some crazy lines. Okay, more soap you use, more brighter your message. If you use a darker paper, then the better. Okay, so how does it work? Which is the magic behind that? So, if you run out of glow-in-the-dark powder, zinc sulfide or strontium aluminate, that's how it's actually called in chemistry, you can go to the supermarket and be an evil person that doesn't care about the environment and buy one of those. If you want to be sure that your party will be glowing in the dark, you should look into the ingredients of the soap and look for optical brighteners. Not what we call oxygen ones. It should be optical brighteners. And they are the trick is, they sell it for making your clothes more white. They are actually not cleaning more your clothes than the other ones. What they are doing is adding components that has this fluorescence protein and changes part of the light to another wavelength that our eye then considers it whiter than before. But these components normally are very dangerous for the environment. So fortunately, this trick was very cool when I was a kid, but now less and less and less trademarks are using that. So if you go, you have to look for optical brighteners. Blanqueadores ópticos in Spanish. And normally the component, it's called Stilbene. So normally, but there are many optical brighteners, and most of them, for not saying all of them, are not good for the environment. So you can do that. You can do like this, and then you can paint your clothes, or you can paint your papers. You can do it very, very strongly, like this. That this is not a secret message, but you can do it like that, which is a secret message. But then you have to be really close with your UV light for seeing it. So with that, I think I covered all the components that I wanted to show you that has this cool fluorescence property with the ultraviolet light going to blue or going to green or going to yellow, changing the wavelength. And I just want you to take a look of them shortly, because they are here. These are the chemical components that we have been hunting in our kitchen. Okay, and I think if I do this, this is the Nobel Prize that I have been talking to you about. These are egg flies and fly cellular structures that they have a protein that it's tagged to the lantern protein, that it has this fluorescence protein, receives something almost red and then it becomes green. So you can see that I was not telling you crazy stuff. And also for you to know that this fluorescent property is used also for reading DNA. And many of the PCRs that has been doing during this time use some fluorescent chemicals on it for actually knowing how much DNA product has been produced, the reaction, to know if someone is positive or negative, or this one that is much more fancy that can just go for one change in one nucleotide in the DNA. That's, as you can see, it's real science that's happening now, and using this light property that now you can play with in your kitchen if you want. So I think I said everything I wanted. Now, yes. So if you have any questions, any comments, anything, we can talk about it. It was everything. So.
Maybe I have a question. I was watching like a Netflix movie, Fantastic Fungi, and there was like a lot of mushrooms, like fluorescent, I think. So it works like the same way, like they are absorbing something and producing the light, like absorbing.
It could be. So there is both properties. Bioluminescence and fluorescence are in nature. Bioluminescence, you have an enzyme that it uses oxygen and something else that I don't recall. They do a chemical reaction, and this chemical reaction gives you light. That's bioluminescence. So you're producing light by chemistry. Fluorescence is different. You need to be receiving light, and then you change that light in something with less energy. And there are many mushrooms that have the first one, they are bioluminescent, and there are some other things in nature that are fluorescent. like, for example, the jellyfish that got the green fluorescent protein gel that we use also in our experiments. So it can be both. Depends on the species and the genome of the fungi. So, yeah, but you understand the concept, right? So I don't know why I didn't do it in a proper way, but I will show you again this one. So when you are fluorescent, what you do is check, take something from that part of the spectrum and you change it to something that's more in that direction. So you have a wavelength that's a little bit longer that we call the emission wavelength, and then you convert it in something that's more with less energy or with a wavelength that's a little bit shorter. And what we have been doing is like using this one, and then we can of go from not seeing it because it's not in our eye, and then they are able to convert it here. So my lantern is the here, and then our light was sensing that part, which is in the other direction, not the one that's normally typical. We have both, but normally are in that direction in nature. But some chemicals can do it that way. And then you don't need machines. Because when you are doing, when you are using the images that I show you in the microscope, what we do is we shoot the sample with a wavelength that our eye is able to see. So we need something that filters that wavelength and allows the other one to go through. So we need, for example, we call it filters, but they are something that has color that allows the red not go through it, but the green goes through it. Otherwise, you will be looking and you only will see the light that you are using to illuminate the sample. But if you, we don't have that in the kitchen. So we need the trick of using something that our eye doesn't see so good, and it's converted in something that your eye can actually see. That's the trick of not having a filter. That's what we did. And if you have any other question, or you want to drink something of what we prepared? Okay, so thank you so much for attending and enjoying the chemistry of your kitchen. Bye.